8th class onwards, we can start with the first law. Okay, so we have discussed two polytropic processes, right? So last class, we discussed this yesterday. Anyone was able to derive this? Can you get?
Yes, sir.
From here to here?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Simple algebra only, so I'll not go into that details. Basically, if you substitute, you will get this. So this is the final form of work done for a polytropic process. Okay, now let us look at how a polytropic process looks like, or what exactly is a polytropic process. So basically, for a polytropic process, how do we define? We say that PV to the power n is constant. Okay, now this n could be anything. It could be zero, it could be an infinity. So how this curve, or how this process will vary with n? That is what we'll try to explore today. So for n is equal to zero, so what will happen? N is equal to zero means P becomes constant, right? So this is a isobaric process. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let us say that n is 1. What it will be? Which process?
Isothermal.
Isothermal.
So if n is equal to 1, it means that PV is equal to nRT, or PV is equal to constant and temperature is constant. So it is isothermal process. Now let us take n is equal to infinity. N is equal to infinity means that V to the power infinity is constant. So V has to be constant. Yes? Any question on this?
Sir, how, sir, that last n equal to infinity?
Okay, so see, if any variable is there, if that power of that variable is constant, power infinity. Okay, so let us say x to the power infinity is constant. So it means that if any, even if a small change in x is there, that will not be constant, right? Because it is raised to power infinity.
Yes, sir.
So that's what, if V to the power infinity is constant, it means that V has to be constant. Okay.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
So it becomes isochoric process. Now last one is n is equal to gamma.
Adiabatic.
We will
isentropic.
Okay, so this is again when we talk about entropy, we'll go in more detail. But you can say that gamma is a number, and S is actually entropy. We'll go through this after the second law of thermodynamics. But as of now, you can just note down that for n is equal to gamma, this process becomes isentropic. That's all. Okay. Now let us talk about the free expansion. Okay, let's say that I have a chamber, a big box, where there is a partition between. Okay, so one side I filled it with some gas at some certain pressure P. Other side is vacuum, so there is no gas here. It's going to be perfect vacuum. Now what will happen if I remove this partition, middle partition?
Gas will expand.
Gas will expand. It will fill the whole container. Okay. Now the question is, what will be the work done?
Zero, sir.
Zero.
P external is zero, sir.
What is zero?
P external. Pressure is zero. So the work done is zero.
Yes, correct. So you have already read it somewhere, or how do you know?
Sir,
my first class, sir. In 11th.
Already, sir.
What?
12th class, sir.
Not one person at a time.
Okay. 11th.
You have studied this. Good.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The highest.
So another issue with that is that, okay, remember this slide. We have talked about quasi-static and non-quasi-static process. So during free expansion, that is not a quasi-static process. Okay, this I hope you don't have studied. So when we do this PDV integration, it can only be performed at when it is a quasi-static. Since this is not, the expansion is not a quasi-static, so we cannot use actually PDV. But since there is no opposing force in free expansion, so work done is zero. That we know. Fine. Okay. So flow work, let us skip for that. And some other standard configurations are there. They are actually not very important for most of the systems that will take, but still you should know how to calculate this work done. So, for example, extension of a solid bar. So basically we are stretching it out, and work done is because we are acting against the normal stress. Okay. So this is the work done for stretching from point one to point two. Similarly, for a liquid film, if you stretch a liquid film, you are working against surface tension. So that is the work done for stretching. So these are some common examples that I wanted to explain once. There are some more examples. So let us say work done by electricity, electrical work done. So that will be voltage into Q is charge, or you can write IDT. So this is electrical work done. Similarly, power transmitted by a shaft. So suppose one shaft is rotating at some rotational speed, let that be T. T is the torque. Torque into d theta will be the work done. Okay, so we'll not have many numericals on that. Just for your knowledge, I have added this supplementary. Now, what are the units? Okay, so SI unit is joule. For work done, the SI unit is joule, which is equal to 1 Newton into meter. Or for most of the examples that we'll see, we'll generally use a larger unit, which is kilojoule, 1000 times of joule. Similarly, for power is actually the rate of doing work. Okay, what is the work done divided by what is the amount of time in which the work is done. So that will be watt. 1 watt is 1 joule per second, or simply you can say for kilowatt, 1 kilojoule is 1 kilojoule per second. Okay, now again we'll talk about specific work, small w, that will be joule per kilogram. And generally, British units used horsepower, which is equal to 550 feet. Okay, or I can say 746 watt. So this generally this is used for a power rating for a motor or something. But generally, for our numericals, we'll try to use SI units, joule. Okay. Now let us talk about heat. So what is heat? Basically,
sir, yes. In the previous slide, what was LBF per second?
Pound force. 550 feet pound force, pound per second. So this is basically British unit. Don't worry about that. We'll be trying to limit ourselves with SI units only.
Okay, sir.
Okay, but this is a very common unit. For example, in electrical motors or pumps, we talk about horsepower. So you should just have idea that what a horsepower means, or you can just remember this. One horsepower is 746 watts. Okay, so you forget about this, just focus on this.
Okay, sir. To convert
in SI units. Okay, let us talk about heat. So for work, we see that we integrate area under the curve, PV curve, that gives us total work done in that process. Similarly, for heat, we will integrate area under the TS plot. Okay, so T here is temperature, S is for entropy. We'll talk about entropy later, but let us say that it is some property. Okay, don't worry about entropy, but let us say some property X or Y. So basically, we are plotting any process in that TS plot and take the integration of TDS. That will give us heat. And similar to work, it is also dependent on path. It is an inexact differential. I'm not writing dq here. Okay, even if I will write it's like d and slash. So this is the denotation for inexact differential, similar to what we see in work. Okay, so this is not area under TS plot. Basically, this area we're talking about. So if you take this area, so area under this curve is giving you heat transfer
for a particular. So kind of one, sir.
Yes.
So kind of 1 second, I explain inexact differential.
Inexact differential is that you were there in the last class.
Yes, sir. I mean, again, I forgotten that one.
Okay, fine. So basically, you see that heat or work, they are dependent on path. Okay. So let me then go back. Okay, so what you see here is that if I talk about volume, specific volume, I can integrate it like this. I can write dv, I can integrate from 1 to 2, I'll get delta v. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So it will not depend on path. For any path I take, for example, path A, path B, every time I'll get delta v is v2 minus v1.
Yes, sir.
Okay with this?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is it clear? Now,
yes, sir.
Work. So this is exact differential, okay, which I can write as dv. Now if we talk about work, we know that integration of this path gives you work done, which is basically area under the curve. Now the area under the curve will be different for all the paths. Okay, it will be different for A, it will be different for B, it will be different for C, right?
Yes, so, sir.
Work done will not be same for all the paths. So I cannot write something like this.
Yes, okay. Sir.
This is wrong. That's why we say that it is not right to write like this. I cannot say W2. W2 is does not have any meaning. I can say W1 to 2. Okay, work done in that.
Yes, form. Sir.
And then I can I need to write this D dash W. So it means that this is an inexact differential.
Now, yeah, understood, sir.
Fine. Moving on, let us go to what we had. Okay, this we finished. Yeah. So this was well what we are discussing. So for heat also, heat is also an inexact differential. We need to integrate and we'll get TDS will give us heat. Okay, now some basic definitions. You can read it once. So basically, what we are trying to highlight here is that heat is a form of energy that we all know. The key term here is that it is transferred across the boundary. Okay, we don't say that my system has so much of heat. We always refer to in such a way that Q amount of heat is transferred from system 1 to system 2 or from system 2 surrounding. So it is always the energy at the boundary, okay, and it also obviously it moves from higher temperature to lower temperature, okay, by the virtue of temperature difference between the two systems. So this is all we know from common observation or common sense. But important term here is that it is a boundary phenomena. It happens at the system boundary, okay. So that's what is mentioned here, that a body never contains heat. Okay, we cannot say that this system has X kilojoules or X kilowatts of heat. So it is only identified as a transfer, okay, as it crosses the boundary. So this is a transient phenomenon. Okay, so these are some of basic definition for heat transfer. Now let us see the units. So similarly, heat is also given in joules as we have for work, okay, and the rate of heat transfer Q dot is, so you see a dot here, dot is for rate, okay, so Q is the heat and rate of heat is Q dot, which is given in watt or kilowatt. Specific, again similar to work, specific work it is joule per kilogram, and the British thermal unit is basically, it is defined as amount of heat required to raise one, this is 1 pound, Okay, 1 pound of water from basically they are talking about, this is a standard unit. Okay, so it is defined in some standard terms. So it actually means that 1 degree Fahrenheit, but they have also fixed the temperature. So you have to go from 59.5 to 60.5. Then you say that one unit of BTU has been used. Okay. Similarly, calorie is a very standard unit of heat. We generally work with joules, but calorie is also one of the like historically important units. And there again, we say that use 1 gram of water. Okay. Take 1 gram of water and heat it from 14.5 to 15.5. Why? Okay, any guess why these temperatures are fixed in such a way? Why not 20 to 21?
The specific heat maybe depends on that temperature range.
Yes, very good. So, specific heat that is not varying very abruptly, but still it varies for different temperature. So, when I want to fix my unit, this is a very standard unit, right? So then people have defined it based on this fixed temperature range, that you go from 14.5 to 15.5, 1 degree change, that is for 1 gram of water, that will give you 1 calorie, or 1 calorie is required to make that change. Okay, so this is just about units. Again, we'll mostly try to focus on use joule or kilojoule. Okay, these are some other units that it should be aware of. Now let us talk about what are the similarities, how heat and work are similar. Okay, so both are boundary phenomena. Okay, so we see on the boundary, we don't say that heat is there in a system or work is there in the system. System performs work or system transfers heat. So it happens at the boundary. Again, similarly, system does not possess any heat. Okay, it is not contained, but it transfers through the boundary when the system undergoes change of state. And as we have explained earlier, that both of them are path functions and inexact differential. I hope this is now clear to everyone. So moving on, let us see how do we calculate heat. Let's say that I have a box which is filled with some gas and some Q or delta Q amount of heat is transferred. I am heating that box. So what will happen because of that? It is a fixed rigid box, basically a closed system. I provided some heat. So what will change?
Temperature of the gas.
Temperature will change, right? So we'll have some delta T. Okay, temperature changes from T1 to T2. Let us say that that is delta T. So how do I calculate that temperature change? So I can use this equation. Okay, so let's say delta Q amount of heat is transferred. M is the mass of the gas, Cv into delta T. So Cv is specific heat at constant volume. So here the volume is constant, right? The box is fixed and rigid box. So volume is held constant, then I will use Cv. So using this equation, I can calculate what could be the heat required for a given delta T, or I can say if that much heat is given, what will be the delta T. So this type of numericals you will get. Okay, and this is the basic equation for working on heat transfer. Any questions on this? Okay, so this is for a closed system where the volume is not changing. So that's why it's called constant volume. Now what about piston cylinder? So let us say that we hold the pressure constant. Let us say this piston has some mass that is anyway constant. So when we transfer heat, then it becomes a problem of
constant pressure.
Yes. What is the question? Please repeat.
She was answering, sir.
Okay, she was answering. Okay, fine. So we'll maintain constant pressure here. So we can say the same formula, this is changed. Okay, so Cp is specific heat for constant pressure. Okay, now you answer, which one will be more? If I give the same amount of heat to both the system, which will have a higher delta T, which will have a
Cp is greater than Cv.
Okay, Cp is greater than Cv, that you all know, but you are correct to understand.
In pressure, one work is also done little bit.
Yes, so that forms the basis of new chapter, that is first law of thermodynamics. Okay, so let us stop for today. We'll see why Cp is greater than Cv, or why work done will affect, that we'll talk about in the next chapter. Okay, we'll stop for today. If you have any questions, we'll try to answer.
Sir.
Okay, let me just stop recording first. Yes.
Sir, is the value of Cv less than 1?
No,